Well, it's good to see you this morning. It is always a great time in the house of the Lord to be able to come together, and great to be able to celebrate with Joe his birthday. And he is just a beloved saint here at Faith, and we're so thankful for him and how God uses him in his life. Well, it's a blessing as we continue in our study in Joshua to be able to look at the various characters that God has put in front of us. This morning we'll be studying one of the requests that one of the godly men in Joshua has before the Lord, and that person is Caleb. If you need a Bible this morning to follow along, please slip up your hand. We'll make sure that you receive one. Steve was mentioning to sign up for the mystery dinner, and he mentioned how mystery dinner, whenever I think of mystery dinner, I think of Bible college. Little tiny Bible college out in the middle of a cornfield, and they had no money to feed us, and so we had every meal was mystery meat. And they just came out, one of the big fast food restaurants has mostly soy filler in their chicken. And that came out, and that was a big deal in the news this past week. And I thought, we knew we were getting 90% soybean every meal. And we used to joke about it. We used to talk about this mystery meat, and it got to be such a topic of discussion that they threatened us with demerits. In fact, some did get demerits for complaining. So I learned not to complain. So I also learned to eat anything. So so this mystery dinner, I thought, well, I'm not going to come to the mystery dinner because they asked me to proof the text in the very beginning, and I looked through it, and now I know who killed the person. So what's the point in coming for a mystery dinner if you already know who the murderer is? Well, that was great, and then we had the boat accident, and now I can't remember. So after the service today, I'm going to go out and sign up. It's killing me. I don't know, no pun intended. Enough already, right? Joshua chapter 13 and verse 1, Joshua was old and advanced in years when the Lord said to him, you are old and advanced in years. Now, you might feel old, but when God tells you you're old and you're advanced in years, you know that train's coming, don't you? You can just kind of hear it coming down the tracks. And God says to him that very much of the land remains to be possessed. This is the land that remains, all the regions of the Philistines and all those, and he goes on and he describes all of these different places where yet there was to be conquering done. And God would say to him, I will drive these people out before the sons of Israel. Only allot to Israel for an inheritance as I have commanded you. Now therefore apportion this land for an inheritance to the nine tribes and the half tribe of Manasseh. Well, God has been working a plan. God has been driving the enemy out of the promised land in front of the people of Israel now for several years. There has been some great things done. In fact, Joshua, just previous to this, in our last message, he would say, and the land rested from war. And so some really good things are happening here with Joshua. But now Joshua is getting old. And God says, we're going to shift the plan, as it were. And now the nine and a half tribes who are on the western side of the Jordan River are going to be the tribes who are going to take possession of these little pockets that are still standing and need to be conquered for God. And God says, don't worry about it. As I've been with you all along the way, and as I've done all these phenomenal miracles, so I will also drive these people groups out as well. And so Joshua is to be emboldened as he grants to these various tribes the allotted portions that God has for them. When we get to chapter 14, we're going to find out about a specific request. For there is a man from the tribe of Judah who comes before Joshua and asks for a land grant. Ultimately, what he's looking for is the blessings from Joshua to him. And ultimately, as I think of our walk with God, we look for blessings from the Lord as well, do we not? Let's look to the Lord in prayer and just ask God to bless our time in his word this morning, shall we? God, we come to you this morning thankful for the examples that are before us. Men and women who by faith have really stood out from the crowd. I think of Joshua, Lord, as he is commissioned there in chapter 1, and I think of how he has stood firm for you. There have been challenges, there have been scary moments, there have been difficulties, there have been countless times where he just needed to fall upon you in faith and let you provide. We think of Rahab, Father, a person who is not of great esteem in society there in Jericho, but a person who is esteemed greatly in the scriptures because of her faith. Father, how I thank you, how you changed her life. I thank you, Father, for the fact that she came to faith and truly trusted in your name. I thank you for the examples in scripture like Caleb, who we're about to examine this morning. Help us, Father, to draw strength today from Caleb's testimony. And help us, Lord, this morning to really grab a hold of what he is asking for and why, that we might understand the eventual blessing that falls upon him from Joshua's mouth. May you be lifted up and glorified, and may we, as your children this morning, seek to be blessed by you and to bless you, Father. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. As we come to chapter 14 here in the book of Joshua, we're looking at a portion of scripture that mentions some of the territories. And it kind of starts off here in chapter 14 and verse 1. These are the territories which the sons of Israel inherited in the land of Canaan, and it goes down through a description. He says, for Moses had given the inheritance in verse 3 of the 2.5 tribes beyond the Jordan, but he did not give an inheritance to the Levites among them. So the Levites are that one tribe that stands out. He says, the sons of Israel did just as the Lord had commanded Moses. They divided the land. And then in verse 6, we're introduced to the sons of Judah, who drew near to Joshua in Gilgal. And Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, you know the word which the Lord spoke to Moses, the man of God, concerning you and me in Kadesh Barnea. And he begins to recount what has happened. If you're taking notes, you'll want to put down that this is one of the five stories in the book here that we have before us, where people are coming to ask and receive their inheritance. We have Caleb here, we have Achsa in chapter 15, the daughters of Zelophehad in chapter 17, we have Joseph in chapter 17, and the Levites in chapter 21. And these five examples are termed the land grant narratives. And in a land grant narrative, what we have is we have a case that's being provided for us. And in the situation with Caleb, we have someone who's coming and they're asking for a portion of the land, and they are going to make their case why they should receive that land before Joshua. And this is what we're seeing here with Caleb. So when Caleb comes to Joshua, he wants to state his case so that he would be presented this land. Now, Caleb is an interesting man. He's an interesting man on a number of occasions. I think of how Moses was selected by God. And we know the story of the burning bush. And then I think of Joshua, who is that heir apparent for Moses. And God comes and he puts his hand on Joshua and he says, Joshua, this is what I want for you to do. And as well known as Joshua is, we oftentimes as well think of Caleb when we think of the book of Joshua, don't we? But Caleb is not someone who is of great heritage. He's not someone who's super educated. He's not someone who's super powerful. He's not any of those types of things. The one thing that makes him stand out from those in the crowd is his faith in the Almighty. This is exactly the same thing that can be true of you as well. You may say, I have nothing special to offer. I don't know anything particularly. I was not educated in some great seminaries of the world. I wasn't any of these things. My parents don't even know the Lord, perhaps. Perhaps none of those things are true about us. But we can be blessing to the Lord through our faith in the Almighty God. And if we will walk by faith, we will see things accomplished for God that we would have thought to be impossible. When I think of what God requires from us, Caleb is such a perfect example, isn't he? Because God just is looking at your life and my life, and he's asking us to walk by faith and not by sight. He says to us, trust me. Follow me in such a way that I can provide and I can win the day for you and I can show you what I have for you. And so we're introduced to this man, Caleb, and he begins to recount some of the great things that have happened. Now, this morning, what I'd like for you to see is that you and I need to set our sights on the final goal of receiving the blessing from the Lord. And in this situation with Caleb, what we have is his case basically comes down to four things. The first thing he states is that I followed the Lord. Notice here in verse 7, he says, I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land. And I brought word back to him as it was in my heart. Well, we've got to take our Bibles and go back to Numbers chapter 13 to again examine what exactly is happening over here when Moses sent out the spies. Because we know that there's one spy sent from each of the 12 tribes. And the Bible says that it was God's idea to send the spies into the land. It wasn't Moses' idea, and I want you to see that. Chapter 13, verse 1, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, send out for yourself men so that they may spy out the land of Canaan, which I am going to give to the sons of Israel. You shall send a man from each of their father's tribes, every one a leader among them. And so this is what happens. He lists all of those people, and you can see there in verse 6 that Caleb's name is mentioned. By verse 17, when Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan, he said to them, go up there into the Negev and then go up into the hill country. See what the land is like and whether the people who live in it are strong or weak, whether they're few or many. Well, we know the situation. They've gone up there to check it all out. And the Bible tells us that they came to the Valley of Eshcol. From there, they cut down a branch of a single cluster of grapes, and they carried it on a pole between two men with some of the pomegranates and figs. And that place was called the Valley of Eshcol because of the cluster which the sons of Israel cut down from there. So this is a long trip that the people of Israel are sending their delegates out on. And they're finding that as they're on the way, we know that what's happening here is very significant because this is a very long journey that they're going to be on. But when they returned, according to verse 25, from spying out the land, at the end of 40 days, they proceeded to come to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the sons of Israel in the wilderness. So 40 days has gone by. This wasn't, again, let's just duck in there for a couple days, check the place out. This is a long journey. I'm going to show you a map a little later that shows exactly how far they go because they start off in the Negev way down to the south and they go clear on up to the northern area of Israel. And they go along this little trade route that is along the hill country. This was not an easy journey. At the end of the 40 days, when they came back, the people waited to hear the words from these 12 men. And they went on to say, 10 of them, that this was not going to be possible to go in and take the land. Despite what God was saying, despite how God was leading, this was not reality. This was not something that they were going to be able to do. And so as they came to Moses and Aaron, to all the congregation, the Bible says, while they're there in Kadesh, that they brought back word to them, and they showed them the fruit, and that was the good news, now the bad news, right? We always hear good news, you want good news first or bad news first? Well, here's the good news. This is some serious fruit. And they looked at that, and they probably thought to themselves, well, this is great, let's go. And they mentioned that certainly the land does flow with milk and honey. Verse 28, that's when you get to the bad news. Nevertheless, the people who live in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified, very large, and moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Well, this set the people's teeth just on edge, and there's quite an uproar. All the people, when they heard that news, evidently started to clamor, and you had this huge group of people now making all of this huge stir. Moses and Aaron are standing there, and they're not sure, what do I do? as a leader, you know, what do I do with this mob that's now all upset and they're vocalizing their distrust and they're vocalizing their concern because where are we going to go? How is this going to be possible? Remember, they've come out of a land of Egypt that they're not invited back to. Where do we go from here? We're a nation without a country. Oh, sure, God says we have a country, and God says it's a land flowing with milk and honey, and truly it is, but we can't take the enemy in that land. We'll be absolutely cut down and destroyed. So you can imagine what the crowd was going crazy about this. And there is a man who stands up, and I'm going to guess, but I'm guessing somebody in the crowd was able to whistle. I can't whistle. If I could, I'd really crank one for you. Have you ever been in one of those situations where everybody's making so much noise? There you go. You know, and everybody stops. And they listen, and they think to themselves, whoa! And this is when Caleb steps in. Caleb. Not Moses, and not Aaron, not even Joshua. But it says, Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, we should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we will surely overcome it. But the men who had gone up with him said, we're not able to go up against those people. And they began to push away the advice of Caleb. It got so bad that the Bible says that the congregation in chapter 14 lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. So even after Caleb gets their attention and Caleb says, we can do it. By the power of God, we can go in and take this land. The people wept that night, and Moses heard them crying in their tents because they thought to themselves, life is lost. This is not going to work out. There is absolutely no reason for hope. And the Bible says the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt. It would have been better for us if the armies had caught us on the way out of town. If the Red Sea hadn't parted and we'd have been slaughtered on its shores, it would be better. Or would that we had died in the wilderness. Oh, if the manna had just stopped. If the quail had just stopped. If God had just left us there to starve to death, we'd be better off than we are today. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? See, that was their attitude. Our wives and our little ones will become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? And so they said to one another, let's appoint a leader and return to Egypt. We need somebody other than Moses here to take the reins. And Moses and Aaron fell on their faces in the presence of the assembly of the congregation of the sons of Israel. Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb, those who spied out the land, tore their clothes, and they spoke to the congregation of the sons of Israel, saying, the land which we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. I want you to know that when the 12 tribes or 12 men came back, the 10 who said, no, we can't go into that land, never one time reference Jehovah. They not one time reference God. They looked at it from a human standpoint, and from a human standpoint, I would tend to agree with them. It was going to be absolute suicide to go in there and try to take this land. But it is not about going alone. It's not about traveling the road we're on without the help of God and the Holy Spirit. Amen? You see, we're not left to our own. And so when the reply comes from Joshua and Caleb, the first thing they say is that this land that we pass through is great land. And he says, if the Lord is pleased with us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Oh, don't rebel against the Lord. And do not fear the people of the land, for they will be our prey. Wow, what a way to look at it. You see, there are two very distinct ways to look at the obstacles that face you. You either look at them from a human standpoint and you sit there and you say to yourself, there's absolutely no way that victory can be won.
You can get very depressed. You can cry in your tent. You can wish things had turned out differently. You'd made different life choices. But understand this, that the God who is leading you along will take you through. But you've got to follow him, and you've got to follow him fully. Well, the case was made to the people of Israel, but the Bible says, but all the congregation said to stone them with stones. Now, this is a pretty dramatic situation there in verse 10, isn't it? So there you are, you're Joshua and Caleb, and there's Moses and Aaron. They're prostrate on the ground, praying to Jehovah God. They're distraught. The people have been wailing all night. They're in their tents. It's a sad scenario, and there is Joshua and Caleb crying out to the people to trust the Lord. And the people's reaction was, let's get stones and let's kill these guys. We're tired of hearing about it. That's pretty dramatic, isn't it? And the Bible says the glory of the Lord all of a sudden shone. That must have been a moment, huh? Wouldn't you have loved to have been there? Probably not. It would scare you to death, and me too. But the glory, the Bible says the glory of the Lord appeared in the tent of meeting to all the sons of Israel. And so can you imagine the glow, the fire, the brilliance of the glory of the Lord there in that tent, getting the attention of the people, and one by one, or maybe all at once, they drop those stones. We know that the people garnered the wrath of God because of this. God said, I'm going to destroy them all, and Moses interceded. That's the short version, and we know that God says, yeah, there's a compromise coming, and the compromise is this. These who are adults will die in the wilderness and will never see my promised land. Only those who are less than 20 years of age will go in and see it. And those two other men, Joshua and Caleb, will also go in. Notice with me here as we continue to look at this. It says, so the Lord said, I've pardoned them according to your word, but indeed as I live, all the earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord. Surely all the men who have seen my glory and my signs, which I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not listened to my voice, shall by no means see the land which I swore to their fathers. In verse 24, it says, but my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit and has followed me fully, I will bring into the land which he entered, and his descendants shall take possession of it. Oh, you see, God allows for Joshua and Caleb to remain alive. Notice at verse 36. As for the men whom Moses sent to spy out the land, who returned and made all the congregation grumble against him by bringing out a bad report concerning the land, even those men who brought out the very bad report of the land died by a plague before the Lord. But Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb remained alive out of those men who went to spy out the land. Whew! Let's go back to Joshua and chapter 14. This is Caleb's case. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me to spy out the land. And I brought word back to him as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me made the heart of the people melt with fear. But I followed the Lord my God fully. This is a neat description of Caleb's relationship with Almighty God. Now, the same is spoken there that we just got through reading over in the book of Numbers, where it says that Caleb had a different spirit in him. He had a different spirit, and he has followed me fully. You see, there was something about Caleb that was different than the rest of the people. Caleb was a man who was willing to follow the Lord in such a way that it really made a difference. Now, some places you can see the word there in the Hebrew translated fully. Other places it might be translated, or other versions might translate it wholeheartedly. But I think it really misses the Hebrew's meaning when it gets converted into that method. Because what is so significant about following the Lord fully? Literally, it means fulfilled to walk behind. I want you to think about that. When he says that I followed the Lord fully, he's saying, literally, I walked behind the Lord. I walked behind the Lord. I don't much care to walk a dog. Can I just say that? We live in a development. Our dog's not well behaved. And that dog has to be on a leash. Someone called it a lead. Why is your dog not on a lead? It's a lead. I don't even know what that means. I've never had a dog that had to be on a leash. It's an interesting concept. I always lived out in the wilderness, and you just let the dog out the front yard, and it roamed around on the acreage and came back when it was hungry. And I didn't really need to see it in between. But now we have to take the dog out, and that dog likes to sniff. It's a Labrador retriever, and it sniffs everything, dead and alive. You know what I'm saying? And you find yourself, you can't even walk this dog. I mean, it's like my wife and I want to go for a walk, but it's like we take three steps and then I got to stand there. You don't know how dumb that looks? I mean, somebody driving by probably looks at you and goes, what is that guy doing? You know, doesn't he have a life? And I, my wife's like, do you want to go for a walk? It's like, yeah, let's go for a walk, but leave the dog here because I want to go for a walk. You know what I'm saying? You're always like, trying to pull the dog along. Sometimes in our Christian life, we tend to be this way. We live our Christian life 100 miles an hour like we live the rest of our life. It's like we're just kind of Christians over here, and we're living life. And when we get into a problem or a situation, we expect God to somehow be summoned, and he jumps in front, and all of a sudden, he's there for us. I mean, that's almost like how American Christianity has become. I want you to see this picture of Caleb, who's saying, I'm literally walking behind the Lord. In other words, it's God who's doing the direction. Do you see that? If I'm walking behind God, who decides where we go? God. God leads me and I follow him. Am I concerned? Am I worried? Sometimes I might want to peek around God just a little bit to see what's up ahead. God, there are giants there. God, there is a river there. Lord, did you know you're leading us down to this big river and it's overflowing its banks? Lord, what are you going to do, Father? Can you tell me? You see, the idea here is that Caleb simply trusted God and was willing to follow behind him wherever God would lead. And there was a total trust in the Almighty God as opposed to a summons towards God when things would become difficult. You see, Caleb was a man who listened to God. So when God said to Moses, send out 12 people to spy out the land, and when you send them out, this is the land that I'm giving you, let them bring back a full report of how grand it is. And Caleb heard that, and he went out. And he came back with that report. This is how grand it is. And I'm following God. If this is what God is giving us, I have no question that it will not be done. Well, this stood out. And there was some things said over in Deuteronomy. And the second point I want you to know is that not only does he follow the Lord fully, he also makes his case and he states that Moses promised me this land. And he'll say that even there in chapter 14. He says, sure, so Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land on which your foot has trodden will be an inheritance to you and to your children forever because you followed the Lord my God fully. And so Moses supports that. You have to go back to Deuteronomy, and you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 1, and you see what is spoken there. Deuteronomy 1:34, then the Lord heard the sound of your words, and he was angry and took an oath, saying, not one of these men, this evil generation, shall see the good land which I swore to give your fathers, except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh. He'll see it, and to him and to his sons I will give the land on which he has set foot, because he has followed the Lord fully. he has followed the Lord fully. You see, this event where the people of Israel rebelled against God is evidently, if you look at all of Scripture, something that's very, very significant in the heart and mind of God. You can see this in Psalm 95. It's later quoted again in Hebrews chapter 3. Maybe you remember Psalm 95. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massah in the desert, where your fathers tested and tried me, though they had seen what I did. For 40 years I was angry with that generation, and I said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. But Caleb and Joshua are different. And Moses recognizes it, and Moses says, that place where your foot trod, that will be a place of inheritance. Now, I'm just going to skip ahead. So I want to show you a map that shows in that red line. They start at the very bottom of the map in Kadesh Barnea. That's where the 12 tribes go out of. And they go on up through the area along the hill country, and they actually follow that ridge up north of Hazor that we've already got through talking about there back in chapter 10 and 11. And they go all the way up to the northernmost area there, the tribe of Dan, just almost to the foothills of Mount Hermon. So that's a pretty long trek. They trekked hundreds of miles till they were done in those 40 days. This area here shows you a little bit more of the diversity, and you'll notice there the conquest of Hebron. Hebron's an interesting city. It was actually conquered by Joshua early on. We just got through looking at that. But evidently, the Anakites, some of them, the giants had run off. They also came back and were again residing there in Hebron. Hebron is a neat city. It's at about 3,000 feet sea level and above sea level, and it's right along a ridge. It's an interesting city because it's an encampment of sorts. It was a fortified city sitting there on the crest. And it is one that is built sometime around 1700 BC. Now, Joshua, here in chapter 14, we're talking about 1400 BC. So it's a strongly fortified city. There's a race of giant men called the descendants of Anak who reside there. And it's been there for about 300 years. No doubt when the spies were going through, their eyes got big as they looked at those big giants in Hebron. Hebron, if you know anything about modern history, is also a point today of great strife and difficulty as well. And there's the battle between the Jewish people and the Muslims over who's going to control Hebron. We were there in 1982, and at that point in time, it was controlled by the Jewish authorities and had been since 1967, the Six-Day War. They were able to have that possession. But I still remember people looking at us with some pretty strong disdain that were Arab back in those days. You see, it's a place of burial. It's a place of pretty huge significance. This is the place that Caleb is going to receive. So he builds his case. Let's go back quickly to Joshua chapter 14. Certainly, we see this is a promise that has been extended from Moses, as I mentioned. And then he goes on and he says, now behold, in verse 10, the Lord has let me live just as he spoke these 45 years from the time that the Lord spoke this word to Moses when Israel walked in the wilderness. And now behold, I'm 85 years old today. Now, what's happened is he was about 40 years old when he went out and hoofed it all the way up that ridge line. And then he's been 40 more years since. And so there's about 5 years of conquest that's been going on for a total of 85 years. I believe that Caleb is maybe 15 or more years younger than Joshua at this point in time. We don't receive exactly the description of Caleb's death anywhere in Scripture, and so we don't know that exactly. But he's 85 years old, the Bible says, and he feels great. I'm as strong today as I was when I was zipping around there with Moses. Now, isn't that great? Wouldn't you like to be 85 years old and be full strength? That'd be great, wouldn't it? So this is Joshua, Caleb. He is full strength. He has health. God has blessed him. And he points that out. He says, God is the one who has let me live. And it's important. I'm going to show you why here in just a moment. Not only is he saying, I want this land, I'm healthy, I can handle it, but as well, he is going to say that, you know, if you go back and you look, I have faith in the Lord's provision for this. I'm still a man of faith. Now he says, now then give me this hill country, verse 12, about which the Lord spoke on that day, for you heard on that day that Anakim were there with great fortified cities. Perhaps the Lord will be with me and I'll drive them out as the Lord has spoken. Still the faith of the Lord. If you were looking for an inheritance, wouldn't you want someplace where it's maybe easy to grow stuff, like a plain? How about an area for your animals to graze? Maybe you're going to go that route and be a rancher. Wouldn't you want a place that's fairly settled? I mean, you're 85 years old, right? I mean, 85 years old is still 85 years old. And at this point in time, that's old, even in biblical terminology. At this point in time, they're not living to be 800 anymore, and so 85 is a good age. Wouldn't you want, you know, maybe something that would allow you just to kind of kick back and relax? Have you ever wondered what in the world is going through the mind of this great man of faith when he asked God for Hebron in that area of the hill country? Why in the world does he want that when he knows that there are giants still living there? In fact, the very timing on this is interesting because Hebron is a place that's actually named after one of the great giants. The name of Hebron, the last verse there in chapter 14, was formerly Kiriath Arba. Arba's the greatest man among the Anakim. Whew, we're talking humongous, great renown, an enormous problem, and you're 85 years old, and you say, I want that mountain. Oh, do you remember the song, I want that mountain, I want that mountain? You remember that? Anybody remember that? The Lord has given me. Oh, that's a great song. I sang that as a kid, and I always thought, Joshua and Caleb, these two great men of God, Caleb, why do you want that mountain? And I'll tell you why. The only thing that can come to my mind is that Caleb was so excited about the provision of God when it came to miracles, he just wasn't done with seeing more miracles. He wanted to go up there and see how God was going to deliver even this great Arba into his hand as he has promised. My friends, this is a great man of God because he looks at the capabilities of our Lord and says, I can't get enough. I can't get enough of how great my God is. What is my God going to do next? Oh, how many times we as Christians live our life, we never think about the greatness of God. There's nothing happening in our Christian life. We don't read God's word. We don't pray. We don't see the mighty hand of God. We hear it talked about in messages like this. And we go home and we go to the grocery store and we go shopping and we go to work and we live our normal life. And there just doesn't seem to be anything that's happening. My friends, don't be satisfied with that. Caleb wasn't satisfied with that. Caleb, how about a nice spread down by the river? How about we just build you one of those fancy palaces and the breeze will be blowing through and you can go down to the river and you can bathe yourself. We'll make you some Tommy Bahama shorts. He doesn't want any of that. He says, I want that mountain because there's enemies up there and there's giants and that's what God has given me. Oh, to be like that. Caleb's a mighty man of God. And the impact of his faith leaves a lasting legacy. In closing, let's go quickly to Judges chapter 1. I just want to show you a few verses. In Judges chapter 1, it came about after the death of Joshua that the sons of Israel inquired of the Lord, saying, who shall go up first for us against the Canaanites to fight against them? And the Lord said, Judah is going to go. Now the tribe of Judah is where Caleb is from. And you have to read down through this text, but you see that the victory is being won. They defeated 10,000 men at Bezek, verse 4, and you get the idea that the victories are being won. Then the sons, verse 8, sons of Judah fought against Jerusalem, captured it, and struck it with the edge of the sword, set it on fire. And afterward, the sons of Judah went down to fight against the Canaanites, living in the hill country, in the Negev, and in the lowland. So Judah went against the Canaanites, who lived in Hebron. And again, it's named Kiriath Arba. And they struck these three giants that are named there once again. Then from there, he went again, and he goes down to Debir. And Caleb said, verse 12, the one who attacks Kiriath Sefer and captures it, I will even give him my daughter for a wife. Now that's pretty cool, isn't it? He is down there fighting. Joshua's dead now. Joshua's gone to be with the Lord, and he's still going. And the Bible says Othniel, Caleb's younger brother, captured it. Now Othniel must have been 20 years younger than his brother Caleb, because remember, only those that were 20 and under are going to go into the promised land. And Caleb was 40 years old when that happened. And so here he is, he's the younger brother. I want you to see here that there was a tremendous influence. I don't have time this morning, but there was an influence on Caleb's daughter. She as well is trusting the Lord. And then we see Othniel. Over in chapter 3, when the sons of Israel cried to the Lord raised up a deliverer for the sons of Israel to deliver them, and it's no other than who? Othniel, Caleb's younger brother. There are some really great moments. There are some really bad times. For the Bible says that when the generation that was Caleb's generation had all died off, things began to shift. Notice chapter 2 and verse 6. Joshua dismissed the people. They each went to his inheritance to possess the land. The people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who survived Joshua. That would be Caleb, who had seen all the great work of the Lord which he had done in Israel. And Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110. They buried him in the territory of his inheritance. And the Bible says all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord, nor yet the work which he had done for Israel. And this enters in now to a time of great spiritual darkness. But the legacy of Caleb lives on. His influence in his much younger brother, Othniel, as Othniel would become the first deliverer, the first judge that would come to help deliver a disobedient people who no longer knew the Lord and his great works. My friends, the bottom line is what God wants for us is to be people of faith. After Caleb comes to Joshua, he asks Joshua, will you bless me? And the Bible describes the blessing that is given from Joshua to Caleb. Now, we don't understand in our culture what this blessing really meant. Literally, the word blessing in the Hebrew means to bend the knee. It's the idea of getting down and giving praise. But it is far more significant than that within that culture. You remember Esau, Jacob wanting the blessing. You remember all of that scenario as it goes back and forth. Esau would seek the blessing of God, but never receive it. The blessing was enormously important. And Caleb would receive that blessing because of his faith. And you and I can exercise the same kind of faith in God that Caleb did. And we can receive the blessing of God because of it. Will you be a person of great faith? We don't have to be rich, famous, anything to have the kind of faith that's pleasing to our God. Let's pray. This morning, I'm going to have a word of prayer, but let me just encourage you today. If you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ, how important that truly is. This is what God is asking from us, that we might exercise simple saving faith. Many of you have already come to Christ and placed your faith in Him for salvation. You've called upon His name that He would forgive you of your sin, and He has done just that. Maybe you're here this morning and you're yet to take that step of faith. How I encourage you this morning to look carefully at placing your faith in Jesus and Him alone. If you are here this morning and you have made that choice, placing your faith in Jesus, oh, how I urge you to live by faith, doing those things that are pleasing to the Lord, wanting, desiring to see the working of God in your life. Father, I thank you for these who are here today. May we be people of faith. May we please you by our actions. May Caleb's example, Father, resonate in our hearts today and cause us to think about our relationship with you. Guide us, Lord, I pray. Help us, Father, to be willing to just simply walk behind you so that you are leading us in all things. I pray it in Christ's name. Amen.